Just reading John 12. Let's see here, verse 22. Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and again Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. And Jesus answered them, saying, "The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone, but if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life. If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor." Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Oh, Father, save me from this hour. Ouch. But for this cause came I unto this hour. Now, Father, glorify thy name. Then came there a voice from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." Yes. Now, there was a voice from heaven that said that. Yes. Well, you would think it was the actual Father of Jesus. Yes. But maybe not. Maybe somebody else was talking from heaven. Yeah. But there's what's known as corn, yes, and then there's wheat. Yeah. Now, corn takes quite a bit of water to grow if you think of a corn stalk. And my thought was that all the ethanol and high fructose corn syrup that's been subsidized by the federal government, I'd like to know again the actual physical locations of all the manufacturing of high fructose corn syrup. Yes. And all the ethanol. Now, we as a nation have been concerned about water consumption and fuel. Yes, we have. And let's say that I got concerned as a six-star general that happened to be the general over the United States military. And every admiral and every general is used to giving orders because they're four stars. Yes, but I have two stars more than them because I put two stars on each of my shoulders. And you individuals decided, well, we need the armaments to go to war. And I'm sitting here saying, well, actually, we have a little war going on in our own nation. Yes. Now, there seems to be a dearth, yes, of leadership in the United States military, where we are always being told the war is someplace else. We don't need to defend the atmosphere because it will take care of itself. Yes. We don't need to defend the nation because it will take care of itself. Yes. Because we have elected those that had what? Completely ignored the effects of what they're doing. Now, it seemed that the politicians in each and every one of the states did not want the United States military involved in what they were doing. Yes, because they were elected to make the laws. Yes. But there's this thought that if a state was to include in its laws, yes, what some persons have, well, really defined as public law with the intention of removing all freedoms. Yes. That the United States military would be obligated to enforce those state laws, wouldn't they, state National Guards? Yes! And then the Army and the Navy would sit there saying, well, we're waiting for a war over there. Yes. When there seems to be a war over here. Now, I have the innovations to manufacture 2 trillion gallons of fresh water every year. Yes. Yes. And you have the availability of issuing, yes, decrees of governors about water consumption, yes, and conservation. Right. But the problem is, you're going to tell everybody don't use any water because we're in a drought situation. Yes. And then you're going to employ X number of tens of thousands, possibly hundreds of thousands of employees to fight wildfires. Yes. Where we have the satellite capability of. See, do you understand, Governor? There's a war going on and they did not see it. Now, the puppets, yes, they call themselves politicians, yes, that said we don't have to enforce the laws, yes, He's not going to sue us. Yes. Well, my thought is that the United States right now has a real war going on in this nation to protect the actual nation of the United States. Now, I had designed what I called water balloon planes. Oh, see, I could take an old, what was it, a B-12 or B-52? Yes. Does anybody remember the Korean War where we just bombed the shit out of North Korea and then somebody steps in and we. Could you call North Korea and South Korea? Yeah. Now, I know the South Koreans have done well for themselves, and the North Koreans, they maybe not, are participating what the actual administration wants. But I have nothing personal against Kim Jong-un. They're a very wealthy nation. Yeah, they're sitting on a large mountain range worth approximately $7 trillion. Yeah. And I myself wanted to buy a lot of the natural resources in that mountain range. Yes. Now, I know you say I shouldn't do business with the North Koreans, but I would think that if I could get the laws enforced today, yeah. I had planned on a once-a-year trip with the former premier of China, Wen Jiabao. Yeah. What I thought I'd do is I'd import approximately 3 to 4 very fast hot rods. Yes, those that have blown engines. Right. And then I'd talk to Kim Jong-un and I'd say, "Most excellent leader, I'd like for you to tell all your citizens not to watch what we're doing now." And then I would drive. Yes, Wen Jiabao would drive. Yes, and Kim Jong-un would drive in the middle of the night, approximately 2 a.m. in the morning, as fast as we could right down the main drag of Pyong. We'd have a race to see who could drive the hot rod the fastest. See, I'd keep some of my personal vehicles in North Korea. Once a year, I'd go visit, and then I'd get some of these Harley Davidsons. Yes, we go driving around the mountain range. We spend a week. See, I considered Wen Jiabao kind of like an uncle. Uncle Wen. Yeah, Uncle Wen. I wouldn't try to go to North Korea myself. I'd go through China. Yes, get a special visa to be able to visit them. And then I'd send some Harley-Davidson motorcycles over there with the kind of the touring bikes. Yes. And then I'd negotiate with Kim Jong-un large purchases of natural resources from the mountain range of North Korea. Now, I know as a nation, okay, this is a different type of diplomacy. But I thought as a citizen, yes, if I went through China, yes, and I had with me, well, kind of like one of these retired diplomats that could arrange for things, you understand what he's saying? Yes, that I could go over there once a year, yes, for a week, yes, and it'd kind of be a guy's week away, yes, where we leave the women behind and we just go out there and ride motorcycles and touring through the mountain ranges of North Korea.